If you don't have a Bible this morning, we're doing a book study through Philippians, and there's a bunch of Bibles on the cart always right by the audio stand there. You're welcome to grab one, and we're going to be in Philippians, the second chapter today, as we continue on in our reading through and studying our way through the book. Yeah, I was thinking about when you take the four what we call Gospels, which are basically the four biographies of Jesus that you find in the Bible. You got Matthew and Mark and Luke and John, and they're named after the guys that wrote them. And it's kind of interesting because everybody, they all kind of have their own take on the story of Jesus. And it's interesting to see which things they include that maybe the others don't. And there's one story, it's kind of fascinating because every one of them included this story in their writing about Jesus. And it took place in a really remote location on the north shore of the Sea of Galilee, kind of around, there's a mountain there called Mount Arbel, and it's not like mountain, like Rocky Mountain standards, but for them it's a mountain. And that's where Jesus would go up to pray. And so there's little villages, but they're a couple hour walk from there. And they were out in this area, and the Jesus disciples, he'd sent them out two by two to go into the villages and share the kingdom of God and share about Jesus' love and heal the sick and cast out the demons, do all that stuff. Now they've come back from this experience. Well, the crowds discovered that Jesus was in this area, so they began gathering to hear him teach. And there were, by now, like thousands of people that had followed him. So you can picture this crowd, like thousands of people. And they're in this remote area, and it's getting late in the day. And there are no vendors. There's no concession stands, okay? So the disciples come to Jesus, and they say, Jesus, it's getting late. And it's a couple-hour walk to the nearest villages in either direction. And we need to let these people go because they need to go find something to eat. And Jesus looked at them. And he said, you feed him. Now, put yourself in their shoes for a second. We're in the middle of nowhere. Andrew, who was always the sarcastic one, he even said, 8 months' wages wouldn't buy enough food for all these people. Are you nuts? And Jesus said, no, you feed him. Let's pray. Give us the faith this morning, God, to step up, turn around, and grab hold of the oars. For it's in your name we pray. Amen. Philippians chapter 2, we're going to begin at verse 19. Paul, remember, is in Rome, and he's there under house arrest, and so he's writing back to the folks in the city of Philippi, where he had come and shared the gospel with them. And Paul says, I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon, that I also may be cheered when I receive news about you. So here's the joy. There's part of the joy. I want to send Timothy to you. So that not only can you be cheered by hearing about how I'm doing, but so that I can be cheered by then you send him back and I'll be cheered by that. I have no one else like Timothy who takes genuine interest in your welfare. For everyone looks out for his own interests, not those of Christ Jesus. But you know that Timothy has proved himself because as a son with his father, he has served me in the work of the gospel. I hope, therefore, to send him as soon as I see how things are going with me, and I'm confident in the Lord that I myself will come soon. But I think it's necessary to send back to you Epaphroditus, my brother, fellow worker, and fellow soldier, who is also your messenger whom you sent to take care of the friends. So Philippians, Paul comes to the Philippians, shares Christ with them. Now one of the Philippians is Epaphroditus. The Philippians hear that Paul's under arrest in Rome, so they send Epaphroditus to Paul to encourage him. But Epaphroditus longs for all of you and is distressed because you heard that he was ill. Indeed, he was ill, almost died. But God had mercy on him and did not, not him only, but also me, to spare me sorrow upon sorrow. Therefore, I am all the more eager to send him, so that when you see him again, you may be glad and I may have less anxiety. Welcome him in the Lord with great joy and honor men like him, because he almost died for the work of Christ, risking his life to make up for the help you could not give me. So let's think about these two gentlemen, Timothy and Epaphroditus. At this point in time, when Paul is writing this, we're talking just only, you know, a couple decades after Jesus has ascended into heaven. The whole thing, the whole Christian movement, the whole church is very organic. It's very remote and it's very spread out. So Paul is going on these missionary journeys, telling people about Jesus for the first time. They've never even heard of it. And in the city of Lystra, which is now Turkey, he meets a couple of women, a mother and daughter, and they have a young son named Timothy. And so Paul shares the gospel. Timothy becomes a believer. And Paul begins pouring into him and eventually says, hey, Timothy, why don't you come with me and become a missionary with me? So Timothy does. Eventually, Paul leaves Timothy in the city of Ephesus and says, hey, Timothy, these people need a pastor. I'm leaving you here to be a pastor to the church in Ephesus. And then Timothy went on and met up with Paul later in Rome. Epaphroditus was from Philippi. We know very little about him, but we know that Paul came, shared the gospel. Epaphroditus believed and matured in Christ in the city of Philippi and became a leader in the church and went on to become a kind of a bishop in that area. And I find it really interesting. So what do we know? These are just two local guys who happened to be there doing their thing. I don't know. Maybe they were, you know, Epaphroditus was, I don't know, a baker or a carpenter. I don't know. And, you know, Timothy was a kid. He was a young man. Hadn't even gotten to the point of having a career yet, probably. And yet Paul shares the gospel with them, and these two young men became part of Paul's ministry throughout the rest of the known world at that point. It's fascinating. Jesus said, you know what the weather's going to be like. Look at the clouds, and you kind of go, yeah, the weather's going to, it looks like it's going to snow today. But you don't recognize the signs of the times. So one of the things that I've tried to do on my journey with Christ is to recognize the signs of the times. What is God doing in the bigger picture? And I've noticed in my journey through Scripture that there's this pendulum that kind of swings back and forth. And follow me here. Think about this paradigm. So early on in Scripture with Abraham, you know, you have Adam and Eve and then Abraham. It's very early in history. There's no real structure. There's no established church. There's no established even religion at that point. Everything's really loosey-goosey, and I'm going to call it organic. God speaks to Abraham, sends him angels, sends him messengers. And Abraham's following and having faith, and his family is growing. But there's not a lot of structure to the whole thing. Just Abraham and his family following. He hears the voice, and he follows. Now the pendulum swings and you get to Moses. And Moses and, you know, now all of Abraham's family are captive in Egypt. God raises up Moses, takes him out the desert. And now God creates this top-down structure. Moses, and then you've got Aaron, the priest, and all the tribes. The tribe of Levi is going to be the people who take care of God's temple. And God gives this law. And now all of a sudden we've got some structure. And God's still leading. He's leading them, you know, through the wilderness there. But now we've kind of created this top-down thing. Now we get to the promised land, and there's the conquest, and they conquer the promised land, and the 12 tribes split up, and they go and live in their separate areas. Now we're back to this organic thing, because there's no central government. There's no real political structure. So what happens is if somebody attacks them, well, God raises up a judge. That's the book of Judges. He raises up a judge to lead, and then when the judge dies, there's no judge. So everybody just does their own thing. Very organic, very loosey-goosey. Well, then the people come and they say, you know what? All these other nations have kings. We want a king. And God says, no, you don't, really. because the king is going to lord over you, and is going to tax you, and is going to take your children for service, and is going to, you know, take your money so that he can have a palace. And you really don't want a king. And the people said, no, we want a king. So we have Saul, David, Solomon, and then the kingdom. So we've got the string of kings. Now we're back to top down. Monarchy, everything, okay? Along comes Babylon and Assyria, and for about 600 years, the people of God are under occupation. First, it's the Assyrians, then it's the Babylonians, the Medes, the Persians, the Greeks, and Alexander the Great, and then the Roman Empire, who's in control when Jesus shows up. So for hundreds of years, all they know is this sort of occupational forces doing the political thing. And there's a lot of, and now we're back to this kind of, well, this isn't feeling very good. So the Jewish people hunker down in Jerusalem, and during that time, they create this really strong top down. They center everything around the temple in Jerusalem. And the high priest and all of the Levites, they control it. And they operate like a city state. They had their own currency. They had their own political structure. And all of the Jews, we're under Roman occupation, but we really answer to the high priest and to the religious leaders in Jerusalem. This is the structure when Jesus shows up on the scene. And so what you would expect him to do is like, oh, well, I'm Son of God here, come to earth. Got to go to Jerusalem and talk through the top-down structure, jump through the hoops to become a priest and be a minister. But Jesus doesn't do that. He goes to the North Sea of Galilee. He doesn't go to Jerusalem and go, I need to find some good, studious, educated, well-trained young men to be my disciples. No, he goes to Galilee. He gets four fishermen and this really left-wing, progressive, Roman sympathizer, tax collector Matthew, and this really ultra-right-wing terrorist zealot in Simon, and he takes this ragtag group of guys and he says, all right, you're my boys, and you're going to change the world. You feed them. Wow. So about 300 years later, that's where we're at here with Paul and Timothy and Epaphroditus. This is all organic, man. There's no denominational headquarters. I mean, you got the elders in Jerusalem, and they're kind of, but there's no communication. There's no internet. There's no phone. Paul's out here making this up as he goes, just following the Holy Spirit and God giving guidance. And oh, yeah, Timothy, you look like a good guy. Why don't you come along? Epaphroditus, yeah, I'm recognizing God's word. Yeah, why don't you join? It's very organic, very loosey-goosey. About 300 AD, keep with me here, all right? We're getting somewhere. 300 AD, Emperor Constantine decides to become a Christian and follow Jesus. And overnight, this organic, persecuted group of believers are now the state religion of the Roman Empire. Talk about overnight paradigm change. Now, all of a sudden, the Church of Jesus Christ is the most wealthy, powerful organization on the face of the known world. So guess what they did? They created this top-down structure. Now we will have priests. And the Roman priests, you can only get to God through the Roman priest. Well, that's powerful, isn't it? Yeah, you want to do that? You got to go to church. You got to go through the priest to get to God. Oh, and God's word? Yeah, there's only one language, and it's the one that none of you speak. So you have to go to the priest, and the priest will tell you what God says. Talk about control. Welcome to the Dark Ages. And then about 1,200 years later, 500 years ago this October, a guy named Martin Luther bangs this list of 95 arguments on the door of a church in Wittenberg, Germany, and says, this whole thing is crazy. Everyone should be able to read God's word. Everybody should be able to understand. And I've been reading this word because I'm a priest. And guess what? All the stuff that the church is saying is not what the Bible says. And the Protestant Reformation, boom, fractured the church at that time. And now all of a sudden we're back to organic. And all of a sudden you have these people all over Europe kind of going, we got Baptists and Lutherans and Wesleyans and Armenians and Calvinists and Presbyterians and blah, 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 blah. Now we're kind of back to this loosey-goosey thing. And I find it fascinating because I grew up, you know, when I grew up, there was a very, very rigid system where even we kind of came back to this thing. And I grew up Methodist. Don't hold that against me. I grew up Methodist. Despite everything I learned, I still believed in God. And I'm sorry. I say that in fun. I love my Methodist brothers. But in the Methodist church, I learned that if I, you know, so it's still very, like, you want to be a minister? Okay, you got to go. You got to jump through the hoops. You got to go to the school. You got to go to the seminary. You got to get your degree. You got to go through this. You got to go through the, and then maybe you'll be approved and ordained as a minister of the gospel. And a lot of us are used to this paradigm, right? I find it fascinating. We like to make our pastors into priests. Even when God gives us organic, we come back and go, yeah, I kind of prefer the top-down stuff. And I think that it's important for us to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Beginning in verse 4, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul now is writing to the believers in Corinth. This is a group of Christians just trying to figure things out. Organic, young church, hardly any structure. They're struggling with lots of things, and so Paul is giving them instructions. And he says, there are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Holy Spirit. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working ministry, but the same God works all of them in all people. Now to each one, circle that, each one, every one of the followers of Christ is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one there is given a spiritual gift, a message of wisdom. To another, knowledge by the same Spirit. To another, the gift of faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by the one Spirit. Another, miraculous powers by the same Spirit. And we've got faith, and we've got hospitality, and we've got healing, and tongues, and interpretations of tongues. We've got all these spiritual gifts. And everyone gets a gift. He goes on. The body is a unit. Though it's made up of many parts, and though all its parts are many, they form one body. So it is with Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit into one body, whether Jews or Greek or slave or free, and we were all given the one Spirit to drink. Here's the paradigm that God gave us. You are ministers of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Jesus said there's one body and I'm the head. You're the body. You are my hands. You are my feet. You are my mouth. You feed them. Don't you get it? If you weren't here last week, Tim Brand had the most awesome sermon last week. He had this boat up here, right? And he said, we sit in the boat, like facing the bow. And we're just like, okay, God, do it. God, lead me. God, help me. And God says, step up, turn around, grab the oars, and start rowing. I can't steer a boat that's floating. It has to be moving. Then I can steer it. The same principle applies here. You feed them. You heal them. You share with them my word. You do it. We're all part of this body. But we come back and go, oh, well, you know, but no, Kevin's a minister. Right? Kevin's a minister. Went to school and all that stuff. Keith is a minister. He went to Fuller Seminary. Jenny's a minister. She's on staff. I'm not a minister. No, you are. I was a pastor for 6 years in pastoral, professional pastoral ministry. And then I got doing what I do now, where I'm a business consultant. And that's what I've been doing for over 25 years. And I can remember this bothered my mom to no end. She has Alzheimer's now, so she probably didn't remember it. But she for several years after I left pastoral ministry to go into work in business, my mom would come to me and she'd say, Are you ever going to be a minister again? And people would come to me and say, why did you leave the ministry? And it made me so angry because I wanted to go, read your Bible. I didn't leave the ministry. It's just changed. We are all ministers of the gospel of Christ. Ministry is not just being a professional pastor. Ministry is what we do every day. Oh God, pour out your light on the dark office, spiritual darkness of my workplace. And Jesus says, you are the light of the world. You bring my light to your office place. Oh God, pour out your mercy on these awful presidents and politicians. No, you have mercy on Donald Trump. You have mercy on Barack Obama. And guess what? There is no other plan. When we moved to Pella, the question, I learned this coming to Pella, learning it for the first time. Daughters were in junior high and going into high school. What school are you going to send them to? I love this question. And I could tell that there was a lot behind this question when people would ask. Pella Christian, Pella Public. And you know what? Number one, can't go wrong. Can't go wrong. Great schools, great teachers, great administrations. But here's my concern. My concern was not for how the schools were going to influence my daughters. I was concerned about how my daughters were going to influence the schools. And I wanted them to go to Pella Public. You know why? Because I wanted them to live in the world. I knew that there were people at Pella High that needed Taylor's spiritual gift of encouragement. There were people at Pella High, maybe even teachers, who needed Madison's contagious enthusiasm for the things of God. And it's fascinating. Madison went on into college, and while she was working her way through college, she got this job, and she would rep cosmetics. You know, she'd be that lady that stands at the counter and, oh, let me give you a makeover, you know. And she started doing this to pay the bills in college, and one day I'm like, well, Madison, you seem to, like, really enjoy this. She said, oh, Dad, I do, because I'm not selling makeup. These women walk in and they just feel so ugly. And they're convinced just how ugly they are. And I get to tell them how beautiful God made them. That's a minister of the gospel of Christ. I was in a conference room giving data about customer research that we'd done for our client. Oh, yes, this is the percentage of your customers think this is important to them. And and one of the things the customers say is they like to have a personal service relationship. So one of the things you could really do is try and build a relationship with your customers. You know, show them some empathy, and I'm giving them some thoughts and doing these things. And people are going, well, that's not ministry. Yeah, it is. You know what I teach my clients? Treat your customers the way you'd want to be treated. Guess where I learned that? When somebody, a customer comes to you and they're hurting and they're broken because something hasn't gone right, show them some kindness, some empathy. And one day, after this presentation, I'm doing all this data, and I was really shocked. Now, believe it or not, this is my mission field. When I go into my conference room with my client, I pray when I get in there. I am the fragrance of Christ. I am the light of the world. I am the salt of the earth. I am Christ in this room. I'm a minister of the gospel of Christ, and it doesn't matter whether I'm in business or in pastoral ministry, I'm doing the same thing. And this lady comes up to me afterwards, and she goes, can I ask you something? She was really quiet. Can I ask you something? I said, what? Are you a Christian? I said, yeah, I am. Are you a pastor? I said, believe it or not, I was a pastor. She goes, I knew it. I knew it. See, that's one spirit. That's one spirit in one body. A member of the body was in that room and went, oh, I know. Oh, yeah, I feel that spirit. I know who that is. That's salt and light. That's salt and light. I'm going to ask the team to come up for worship. And as they do, I want to ask you to repeat after me. I am a minister of the gospel of Christ. Say it again. I am a minister of the gospel of Christ. Maybe you don't feel like it. Maybe you feel like God could never use you. Maybe you feel like, no way, I don't know what to do, and not me. I don't know what my gifts are. I don't know what God would have me do. There are going to be prayer warriors. Folks from our prayer ministry will be standing up here along the sides of the room. You know what? The Bible says, Paul said that, you know, even when Timothy, this young guy who wasn't even educated, became a gospel, they laid hands on him and commissioned him. Maybe you need to come up this morning and say, you know what, I don't feel like a minister. So that our prayer team can lay their hands on you, can pray for your commissioning, for wherever God's going to take you this week. Maybe you need to come up while the elders have the body and the blood of Christ and the bread and the cup. And let Jesus, through communion, come into you. And know that it's not for you to hold on to, but to pour through you into the world. God, Holy Spirit, breath of God, blow, breathe out on us. Move your people out of this room into their homes, and their work, and their offices, and the community, and the streets, and the cafes, and the restaurants, and the bars. Take us out to be your hands and your feet. In the name of Jesus.